confronted with larger and yet unfought battles and the likelihood of self-produced disaster.
Oh, I hit repeat instead of stop. I'm sure that makes sense. We'll get it again. They're already confronted with larger as yet unfought battles and the likelihood of self-produced disaster, and they must now be addressed with the possibilitarian imperative to rise up to their post-battle history existence. The anti-disaster battle cry, the battle cry that life demands of them and of us, to realize a possible world, the possible world that the disaster world actually needs. And maybe now it is time to put away the plaything of a puppet figure in favor of a more active one, something that reminds us of the ways in which we are not puppets. Maybe I'll cut the strings and turn all of my puppets into effigies. Effigies are puppets that burn. Effigies are politics in action. Effigies don't have a puppet's spirited animation, but their makers do. And when the flames engulf the effigy, we don't see the doll, only the daring. Yes, I think it's time to burn it out.
So, you know, I've gotten to know you a little bit in the past, but many of you, not everyone, but a number of you in the past couple of hours. I have a sense that you haven't been to a lot of readings before, many of you. It might be true. So I'll say first, before I start, that you have permission to laugh when it's funny. If it's funny. It's funny to me, so I like it when people laugh. It's meant to be funny sometimes. This book is called Situ. Many of you, maybe you've seen it floating around here over the past week or two. And it's not quite any form of or genre of literature. I mean, it's not poetry, and it's not philosophy, and it's not really expository. It has kind of a plot, but it's not really a novel. I'll tell you that much of the plot happens in the first few pages. So, it has more of a plot than other things I've written. So I wrote another book called Itch, and that is the plot. Though I guess the completion of it is scratch. But that doesn't happen until the last page. Anyway, so I'm going to read from the beginning of this book and just read for a little bit of it. And I'll just do that. Well, I'll say one more thing. It begins sort of in medias res, sort of in the middle of things. So although I'm starting at the top of the book, at the very beginning of the book, it is not, it assumes actions off stage that you'll never know about. That's how I like it. But that's not all. This seat, his seat, has never been another's, has always only been dispensed to find his occupancy near, to suit his nearing occupation, if not the present circumstance of being thereby occupied, of being set upon by only him, by him alone. This is to say that as he turns his gaze back to his harbor, no matter what corrosive goad provoked him to dethrone, the cardinal intimation that his pulp should find no lading on that ramshackle recliner leaves him hardly in existence, hardly corrigibly extant, a manifold of carrying, both drifting past and soon to come, and soon to spoil here. Surely it has happened before, he thinks. He has left his bench before, many times, countless times, which does nothing to prevent him from attempting to count. an essay that's near equal to the feat of its achievement, at least when it's considered from the outside, or the outside of the outside, nearly the inside, but not quite, not yet. He still knows the difference, knows the difference is all difference, every difference held in state, both in and out, in state and kind. There was that one occasion, just the other day, he can almost feel the weight of the sun on his back. It was the last sun, the last time there was a sun, that the weight of the back of the sun was. He can almost taste it. That's what they say. That's what they say, that one can almost taste it when one thinks that one can taste it. But that's not right, not quite his right, if nothing less obscure. He thinks that if he manages to disregard all other sense, the less of it, the more of it, he thinks it could be all, then he can nearly cast himself back into that last Phoebus, perhaps the brightest double yet to simper through the burnished vault, the vaulting bar. Just the other day. The other day, when he had, for example, left his bench for nothing less than the necessity of leaving his bench, and nothing more perhaps, again perhaps, perhaps again, for nothing more or less than the necessity of leaving his bench, an urgency made manifest by nothing more or less than the perplexed and blushing affect of his calentured cheek, his lips adrift from gums in pained retraction from the glossa and the next ostensive centering of everything that centers on a muscular convulsion of the egress of the split. But no, he thinks, not yet, or not again, he'd rather vow. It's always best when yet is made indifferent to again, when one can't tell the difference, when the difference is indifferent and yet again is again yet. Always when what has not happened nonetheless rescinds its done opprobrium of losses and returns that fevered omphalos to some intrinsic innocence of gusts. Perhaps it was the wind made spit to transpierce his latissimus, perhaps his mast fit witless to the porch of his arrival, but it's so he sees it so. For once, he can attend the rule, and this time, just this once, not merely sharp his eager focus on the absence of a speaker spoken to by speaking out. There was a sun the other day. He felt its weight upon his back, but even in the living of that moment, he still failed to think, still rightly failed to think that mass an attribute of anything but his deferred reception, of his burden in its hauling, a fantasy of ballast that seemed sweet as it reached tongue. If he cannot taste it, he cannot bear it, an endless source of trouble in his commerce on the boulevard, however one can say that he has bought or sold his wares. If he cannot taste it, it is not his, this foundling glimpse, but everything that's in it is imputable to him. He cannot think this protean reduction of the scene to some assemblage of distrait associations, of surrenders of the outside to some intimated core. Accordingly, a predicate of his peculiar potency, his binding resignation to a boundless drive, a softening dray. But who is really able to make such returnless venture, allege a confirmation to a vision of achievement, so a practice in the slightest way compelled? An odd rhetorical, who's to say anything, to speak anyway? Thus accepting his unknowing, if unknowable acceptance, of a world that's not on offer, but is taken up by force. The sense of sensibilities not understood as sensate allows a nearer vision of his present paralysis, of what he thinks a vestige of his mindless lookout. Nearer is not inside, it may be, but there's the triumph. To be inside would be equal to a positure, the muse. If it's inside that you're after, then it's inside. Thus revealing his acceptance of a world he thinks is given, of a world he's since received, he's since aroused, you're still too soon. He thinks back to the last son, the only son he's managed to think back to as a likeness, but still he can't lay claim to having ever claimed it present. So to hear fulfill his promise, his next promise to the absent. How else could one model such an aftermath of voices? How return one's thinking to a day so long ago, so long past? Return such empty savor to the trick of having passed? Why not here allow this indiscretion, this offensive, to take one no less willingly than bound towards such presentment, towards some resolve that's set before the passions of the scene to come? To come, it is to come, he thinks, but that is not his present purpose, nor is it. The last son, the only is the last son, and that passed long or short ago, whenever it played out within his inn, it doesn't matter whether it matters or not, that is to say. He knows it can't be known, if for no other reason than the fact that such a standard is precisely what's gone missing since it happened, since it last appeared. Without this subjugation to the discrepating shadow, some atmospheric median to measure up against, he knows that he can't hope to frame the passage of the hours. And without the passing hours, his days appear a nearly insurmountable expanse. Perhaps he can hope, but he doesn't. For him, it's proved impossible to cite what he's collected as a singular impression, as a summary dissemblance, without the sense of passing into typic pose. He remembers only that which is inestimably long ago, for the fact that if the estimate were obvious to him, and that is all that means, he thinks, that viscerous alterity of cherished modes, of modes held dear, then he'd recall the figure of such gustatory ignis whenever it had slithered into happenstance, so had at some present time appeared. All this to elucidate his wholly novel status, his displacement from the outside of the inside of the view, a posture unexampled to the auditors of fortune as they're passing, as they saunter quickly past his septic cipher of a seal. He is, as yet, none other than another, than no other other ought, not only as an other, but as all others, as every other ever ought to be. That some are is, as others ought, is not his pressing problem, but of him, but for him. Enough. He's had enough. But such conditional satiety won't dissuade him from returning to a moment from which he'll soon forevermore depart, when once again the burden of a passing fancy passes into dilatory savor, the radiance coerce a squint from convalescent pupils, and the heat upon his neck impel the sweat to start. He can still recall that day as clearly as clear as this one, but he can see it clearer. It's not that it's more proximate, but that it's limned in greater detail, as a spotlight can illumine in an instant what's been hidden from the easy eye for centuries. When was it, he wonders? No, that's not the crucial question, not the right question, he's sure. Even he, despite his longings, will not foist upon his subjects the vexation of such trivial concerns. Or perhaps that's not the reason. Rather than perhaps. He is yet rather incapable of saying, of deducing when it was that he was last, perhaps still first, but surely last, when he was last afflicted with that menacing exigency, that cavalcade of poses that his plethora implies. It would be foolish to assume the contradiction has escaped him, that such contraction of cross purposes, cross explanations, he believes, as though he might esteem his dreaming motive into some triumphant portrait of conditions not just born out but derived, could slip by without notice, not by tongue or affectation, but by being likewise thrust into an unshared world. It would be foolish, he accepts. And while such foolishness won't push his expedition into shipwreck, he feels it as a shot across the prow. Thank you.